Professor Mahendra Agarwal. He need no introduction. You have already heard him once. So he's going to talk on leadership in research. You can of course ask questions and make it as lively as possible.
Thanks, Jan. And I would like to continue with the model we adopted yesterday.
So, let's use the same model we did yesterday,
a two-way communication.
In fact, in this, I am literally going to provoke. There are many questions for which I do not have unambiguous answers. There are multiple answers. And depending on your one's perspective, one can say this is better or it's not. So I look forward to
a lively discussion on that.
So why is having leadership in research important? Many reasons. I just listed four of them that I thought are crucial. Very important for the visibility of an institution in modern times. So everything is with respect to how things are today.
If you had asked the same question
30 years ago, the answer, at least in India, would have been different. But today, it is extremely important for the visibility of an institution to be a leader in research. The visibility and these factors are interrelated in multiple ways. Visibility leads to it being attractive for good faculty and students. Once you get good faculty and students, it increases your visibility. So it's a kind of a nice synergy that happens. Again, same is the fact with funding. I mean, you get quality faculty and students and visibility, you attract.
And everybody loves funding.
That is one unambiguous statement I can make. The more money you have, the better off you are. This is a very interesting phenomenon which has developed only, I would say, in the past 5 to 10 years. That the societal expectations from our institutions have changed dramatically. 10 years ago, the society was happy with the IITs because we were providing high quality education, producing excellent students who went on to do great things. In the last 10 years, the society is saying, well, this is not satisfactory enough because you guys are ranked very poorly, whatever world ranking of universities are. Those rankings are primarily based on research. So every, at least twice a year, there is a loud lamentation in the media. And twice a year, because that's when two major rankings come out, then why is there no Indian institution in top 100 or top 50? And we repeat, I'm going to go through that same cycle of self-criticism, blame shifting, and whatnot, once in 2 years, twice. But, now this aside, it is an important factor that the society today expects more from the institutions than just good training to the students. And eventually, the society owns the institutions. So if the society expects something, the institutions have to respond. So what makes a university a leader in research? First, you need to get your ingredients right. Without good ingredients, you cannot get good output. Okay, this is, I think all of us know this. So we'll be going through them somewhat quickly.
points of debate
where we can spend more time. Of course, we need bright faculty, it goes without saying. We need good infrastructure in order so that they can do well. We need good support system, that's a very crucial ingredient which is often found missing in the Indian setting. And this is something people don't realize when comparing Indian institutions with outside. The good support system makes the life much easier, which often is not. And good reward system, that is, encourage good performance. Again, this is often missing in Indian system. This constitutes a very important component because, well, this is, okay, this is first point of view. There is a case which is made that people are self-motivated and so they don't need any rewards to perform. So why should there be any reward system? Does everyone agree with this argument?
No.
No.
No?
No.
Why not?
Yes. Even if you are self-motivated, recognition should be there.
Yes.
So that will enhance your motivation level also.
Yeah, but you said yes. Yes. So let's hear from him, then we'll come to you.
Yeah. I think, see, our prime job is to deliver certain expected things. It only comes up as a problem when you unduly recognize somebody over, somebody who is already there. And then when actually we start creating a comparison between equals, actually we consider everyone equal. And then in terms of their delivery, in terms of their, when we take them. No, it's only the system that makes the people actually. There could be some differences at the time of, intake. But then once a person gets into the system, we assume that the system has taken all the points into view. And then now what happens is how the system nurtures a person. Actually, that makes a whole lot of things or not of a person. Now, if you start comparing at different levels, probably I don't think it will really help. Rather than dividing the people, I guess those simple awards that we try to put. Somehow, I feel it should not be there.
So, notice I am making here a subtle distinction between award and reward. So, I'll come to this point in a slightly more detailed way in a couple of times later. But it's good to hear this point. Yes. So I'm not going to respond to them, but I'll just hear it.
Yeah, so again it's about award and reward. So giving a one time award to a person to recognize something, young faculty, you're a good achiever, I think that helps. But if it goes, for example, for we have what is called as institute chair professor. Each department has some number of chair professorships based on the number of professors you would want. So what I found, my experience, is that this creates a lot of tension amongst colleagues. It is just, the people who have got are all performers till now at least. But it's not that all performers do get. And this causes, 25 years of friendship, etc. are broken. It creates a bad feeling, so one has to probably think about this.
Okay. Yes,
sir. Rewards and awards are must because healthy competition is the era. Healthy competition is the era. It is must.
Good. So we have some debating points already. Yes. Yes, you have.
Yeah. Very few people are self-motivated, sir. But when we talk about leadership, it is not about the individual. So for all people, we need reward, award, good infrastructure, everything, sir. So one or two may be a self-motivator. With that, we cannot promote the institution.
Okay, fine. Good, so we'll come back to this discussion. Let's move forward. So let's go through these four ingredients one by one. This is one slide for each. This is a pretty straightforward one. There is not much discussion or debate to be had here. Everybody agrees. Must get bright faculty, bright students. How do we get that? Well, first,
articulate the institute vision very clearly so that everybody knows this is what the institute stands for. There could be, depending on the institute's inclination or objectives, you know, emphasis could be on fundamental research in an institution or technology development or a combination of both. That's up to the institution. But a clear vision must be articulated so that those sitting outside understand this is what the institute is, and then they can judge if they want to be partners. Another very important one, proactive approach for recruitment, both at the faculty and student level. The time is gone when we can just wait for good applications to come in. We have to go out and actively see. And once somebody comes in, provide, it's a new system, a young family that comes into the system, provide all possible help to them to settle down. This is okay. Let's move on. Creating infrastructure, again, you need money, lot of it. That's the only way to create good infrastructure. But the tricky part is, how does one get this money? And again, I'm going to discuss this with respect to the current situation. We can't hope to get much money from. Yesterday we had a debate on this. It's clear that it is not practically possible to expect a lot of money from people. Industry funding is, has its own constraints, and now we have HEPA grants, which allows us an additional source of loan money, interest-free loan money. But that's also limited to the internal revenue generation. So what else? Where else can we get them?
I have one question.
Yes.
For institutions like IIT, they can invite some of the students, sponsored students, with very high fees. That would be 10% of the students, because most of the top institutions, they are also doing this. They are relaxing their fee and all. If they are meritorious, if they are not meritorious, they are to some extent, we have to adopt some private model also. I mean, in that case, it's no harm. The fundings are limited from the government side.
Yes, there is a way to generate some resources, but there are going to be challenges. At the UG level, the restrictions put on the institutions are far stricter. That is how many. Can we really get students on paid seats from at a high number to paying a significant amount of fees? It is not yet permissible. Maybe it will become permissible if we argue for it. But internally also there is going to be this issue of one set of students at one level of performance, and this, the paid students are likely to be at lower level.
But then you have all this spectrum. You have reserved class also.
Yes, so that is actually, yes, you have a point there, because it's probably anyway, it's a big levels of performance in the system already, so it's probably one. Fair enough. So that's one source, and it is something that needs to be improved. How about industry?
It should be primarily from there. Should be really primarily from there, because we say that we are technology, and then going back to the previous slide, we talked about whether the mandate should be this basic fundamental research or technology development. Link, we have to link this industry to technology development and beyond, and that's where really the money should be coming from.
Ideally, yes. I mean, all. First, the here are from IITs and NITs, institution of technologies. But historically, we haven't been doing much technology. And that's one major reason why there is a disconnect between the in a way that what, no matter what is written, but in practice, the focus is not as much. That's the point that I think we all have to come to a realization that it's perhaps time to reorient ourselves. And when I say reorient, it doesn't mean that everybody should suddenly drop whatever they are doing and start doing something else, but encourage people to look at these other aspects and components.
Like research actually is an important area. Industry-supported applied research has to be one of the prime focus of the technical institution.
So this is where I think I'm glad to see this agreement here that we need to move towards or encourage more of applied research, technology development, industry-oriented research as a source of funding and also as a contribution to the society. That is, the societal expectations will be certainly partly met if we can create technologies which benefit the society.
So capacity building also is one of the areas. You know, apart from the industry-oriented research, the industry also requires some capacity building in terms of technological know-how and all.
That's right. There are many things that can be do, but for this talk, I'm only limiting myself to the research part.
Understanding
is so very simple and strained and delayed.
What
exactly is the bottleneck? Okay, so it is not easy to change people. As a faculty, I have spent 20 years in the system, I am used to doing certain type of work. It's hard for me to suddenly decide, okay, now I can focus on something. That's one. Second is that working with industry is a very different model. Because they want things in a time bound fashion. Fundamentally, the faculty don't work in a time bound fashion. They are more used to doing a blue sky research or where it's not blue sky research. The kind of research they are doing is there's really no strict deadlines, so it is 2 months, you like to do this, and then next 3 months, you like to do that. It's not always possible, also, and so that makes, we are not trained to do that kind of work. So that requires some bit of retraining ourselves. That's another problem. Third bottleneck is the industry themselves. Often the kind of work they want us to do is so trivial that it doesn't excite. So,
isn't the need more important than my excitement?
Valid point, but we have to look at it from the both sides. You know, if I can't motivate myself to work on a certain problem, even if it is a great need, won't get done.
So there is another thing, most of the industry, the problem they will identify cannot be addressed by one faculty. But there will be many aspects of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So it requires collaboration.
Yeah.
And the collaborative nature inherently is missing in our
industry. That's a very good point, yes. So that's another aspect. Most of the industry problems, especially the ones that are require collaboration from multiple types of companies, multiple expertise. That doesn't often happen.
That's due to lack of leadership.
These are all points of leadership. Yes, exactly. These are all points of leadership. That is, the institution as a whole and leadership certainly plays a key role there. Need to start thinking about these aspects. Start creating these group-based solutions for specific industry problems.
Because one of your slides you mentioned essential ingredient. So that was student abilities, support system, everything.
Yes. not only not a single ingredient, it's an ingredient or a sprinkling which is present in all of those ingredients. There is, none of that will happen unless there is strong connected.
Otherwise, all IVs are having essentially the same ingredient, but then they are performing differently.
The other aspect is steam cords. Again, we have been quite abysmal failures in engaging with state government and getting funding from it. Is there any IIT here which has got some significant, or any institution here which has got some significant funding from the state government?
The defense corridor, Kanpur and IIT, which you got?
We haven't got.
No, so committed. Committed.
Until it comes.
Yeah, yeah. In the state but government, that is the real risk. Papers and money, both are two different things.
Yeah, yeah. So that is one aspect, one reason. I mean, state government tend to be very frustrating, way too bureaucratic.
And our people tend to get put off to that. That's one reason why it's because of that. Another reason is which points to a drawback from our side, which is state governments are simply not interested in fundamental and good rights. They say, we have this problem in the state. Can you solve it? So it is like the state government is one large industry which is set up very specific problems and they want time-bound solutions. So unless we are ready to commit ourselves to that, the money won't.
But these two, last two points, I think are very important if we want to diversify our funding sources.
If we stay with this, I don't think we can raise significant amount of money. And if you want to create good infrastructure and continue to maintain it, you need a large chunk of money.
So why can't we have an OU with the state? To have in a specific terms like what the research and what kind of academic inputs we can provide to them, or in terms of policy, procedures and all. So why can't each and every IIT or NIT, which is actually located in a particular state, has an MOU and then start delivering on that, in a specified manner, not that on a sporadic manner, and a self be created in the institute and which caters for this?
Yes, that's how it should be. But in order for it to be that, there are certain steps that we have to take. We cannot expect state governments to change their worldview or their functionality overnight. They are what they are. So we have to work with them. And literally it is, we need them more than they need us. So we need to make an extra effort. Creating support system. This is the one that is not so easy in our setup. There is a large amount of purchases that happen in the institution. So a simple purchase process is important. But a perennial complaint from faculty is that any purchase makes them jump through a number of hoops and it takes forever. There is no easy solution to this. There are these big obstacles. I don't want to call them obstacles, but they are what they are. GFR 2017, GM portal, and so many other things which are mandated to perform. So the solution will have to be something that takes them into account. System needs to be set up in a way that it hides away, like you call it computer science, do the abstraction to hide away all the complexities, provide simple APIs to people, to do plug and play. Staff, a huge gap. It's not that we don't get committed staff, but the training of the staff is activity ends up spending quite some time in doing things which could easily have been done by you. On the technical side also, we need good, well-trained technical manpower. Again, we won't get that trained technical manpower off the shelf. So another aspect where we have to invest in training of them. Of course, it can run the risk of the person getting trained, moving somewhere else, but that's, it's not something we need to worry too much about. So the person moves somewhere else to another institution, that person is contributing to that institution. So it should be considered as money or time well spent. And finally, the reward system. That is, okay, that's a controlled streak. I'm now really starting to make it. Here is my belief. Strong performers should be encouraged. Why should they be encouraged? I think many points, some of you have said that everybody is equal. Why create inequality by identifying a set? Okay, this is, this set is doing well. We would ideally like everyone to be equal, but the reality is not. Everybody starts equal, but give them 10 years, you can see differences. At that point, there are two options. One can take a view that, fine, they are doing according to their ability and motivation, and whatever they are doing, accept that. And if you adopt that view, then there is no need for a reward system. The alternative view is, the ones that are doing better, if we can create a mechanism to encourage them through a reward system, they will feel more motivated to do, and the ones that are not, if they see that the others are getting rewarded for their performance, some of them at least will get motivated to try to improve. But in order for that to be done, the reward system should be broad-based. If there are like 10 chairs in the institution, that's not broad-based. That will lead to frustration, because then, you know, those 10 guys are very well. I will never get a chance, even if I do that. So then you get frustrated. If a system is set up so that a significant fraction of people get rewarded in some way or another, then that provides a motivation or ability that anybody can, will then be able to think or believe that, yes, if I work, I can. So I'm not arguing against the chair system. Let there be chairs. But more important is this broad-based reward system. On top of it, you can have whatever else. And the, my logic for doing that or saying that is that in any large, this is a statistical phenomenon, in any large collection of people, 20% are self-motivated, 20% are not motivated at all, and the mid 60%, which is the large majority, need to be prodded or encouraged. Otherwise, they may not do it. So, I have said my point. Let's keep it up. Yes.
I think we have a lot of academic freedom in the system. And the accountability is much lesser. I'm not even sure whether people are looking after their potential. I don't know whether it is a reward system or is it something like, you know, you should at least want people that you work up to their potential. This message, I don't know whether we are sending it regularly to all. So reward is the second thing, but are you really working up to your potential? Or there is a check or balance for this? Or, you know, is there an accountability for every person? So we are all strongly opinionated people, I mean, in general. What I mean is about academicians. And get, that you are not working up to your potential is one of our tough challenges as an administrator.
Yes, actually that is our culture in India. Nobody is accountable. Mm-hmm. So I think the reward system is better in that sense. Because there will be so many people who want to, you know, drink coffee. Accountability is not in our professionalism, I think so. It's like not that one. But the reward system should be designed in certain ways. For example, I have one point, one kind of reward system in my mind that if a faculty is bringing some money, suppose he's bringing 1 crore, institute give him 20 lakh or something like that.
That's
one
model, right?
Yes. So let's not give all, you know, only these, you know, three of kind of, you know. So some effort, if you see, match it with that. So these kind of reward system should definitely be there.
Transparent system.
Yeah. Accountable rana, it's like ideal thing now. Our culture mein accountability rana bahut tough. Because no office, hum academics apne aap ko pressurize karte the. But are our DCs or other bureaucrats are accountable? Nobody is accountable in this India.
So my point is even academicians are not completely
accountable. No, we are not accountable. I mean, if that leads to the second point, but we'll debate that slightly later. Let's debate.
May I request you to
just going back to the fundamental point, what is the definition of performance and performance?
That's a question, big question, yes, that's the second point. How do you decide on who is the strong performer? There is a one easy way to define a numeric metric. 3 papers, 2 PhD students, 20 lakh of funding or something. Amalgamation of numbers. Any precise metric here is disaster.
Like GPS course.
Because the moment you precisely define, and we have seen enough examples of this for being done by UGC and other agencies, you will make a precise sequence of numbers to be achieved, people will get this. So you have to make it imprecise. So that means necessarily it becomes subjective evaluation. If you have to do it a subjective evaluation, you have to get it done by domain expert. Otherwise you can't evaluate properly. There is a hard part there as well, because the moment you become make any criteria subjective, it is open to debate. I can say, look, I think I am much better than what I have been evaluated for because of. No one argument that would imply that this person is good or not. So, a subjective evaluation criteria, although is required to avoid gaming the system, has its own inherent drawbacks. So, one way or the other, we have to live with this imperfect evaluation. My personal choice is the second one, because I have seen enough examples of this pure numeric system being ending up in disaster.
Yeah. According to me, reward system has to be there in an educational institution. Because as you rightly said, initial stage, all are equal. But 10 years down the line, whoever is working, especially due to self-motivation, I can say, he has to be rewarded. And I also feel that from my experience in a university system, I feel that the most non-accountable job in this country is teaching. Whether you teach or not, students are not bothered, they only look at the mark. You know, whether you come to the class or not, you are getting a mark, therefore nobody is questioning it, the students are also not questioning. Therefore, the reward system has to be there for the institution.
Okay.
This
prepares
everywhere
in
India.
normally motivated, not that you give an award and they will do, that's not the case. oh, it's the people who are at that 60% what you said, whether there's any missing enabling environment which is preventing them. Because there must be some lacuna or some kind of deficiency which is probably causing this underperformance of those 60%. And the remaining 20, I agree, but there could be a little more effort you have to put, much more effort. But what I feel is maybe the award, I don't know, is not the only way actually.
Yes.
Sir, everybody is talking about the awards. Okay, should be there. But one thing I would like to mention here that why that India is not producing any Nobel laureate. One thing which I feel that for groundbreaking research, it can only be done if you are self-motivated. If you are not looking towards awards, you see the great scientists. Or not after any awards, just see their studies. So the self-motivation is required if you want to do some groundbreaking.
But those are groundbreaking research I'm not talking about here because that has nothing to do with leadership. I mean those are geniuses or exceptions. Whether you are there or not there doesn't matter, they will do their own. As a system, once we look at the system, we need to look at the large track, the number of people. And we can't assume this similarities and work based on that. We have to look at the entire spectrum and what try to improve that.
So instead of what you're talking about, the reward or award to the strong performers, why don't you take it otherwise? Can you evolve a system where we can punishment to the low performance? I think that will change.
I am sorry for that.
The numeric parameters, evaluation by experts, I think the simplest way is that every year we used to give our own performance appraisal report to the university where it is in the form of, it comes in the form of annual report. So annual report itself sufficient to tell whether a person is a performer or not, whether a person is not a performer, because it gives details about the number of publications and also the amount of fund that a particular person can mobilize for his own.
So that's where it comes numeric. And number of publications, amount of money brought in, these are all numbers. And these numbers, of course, are useful. I'm not saying these numbers should not be used, but should be used with care. So general consensus, with the exception of course, there is an important point being made by you, create an enabling environment which encourages people to perform instead of creating this sort of hierarchy in the system where those who are rewarded and
why we are taking this in sports, one is another is not.
So there is, yes, yeah, so no, this is a fundamental debate between a working in an environment which is very collegial, comfortable, tension free, versus working in an environment which is competitive and with stress, somehow. It has been routinely, it has been found, if you look at the studies, the competitive environment makes people perform better. This is unquestioned. At the same time, the competitive environment also affects the health and family life.
Yes.
It's both. So you get good with bad. The choice is
but sir, why this is in India only? Why
it's everywhere.
It's
not affected. Of course, look at the divorce rates among assistant professors in U.S. universities. They are really high. So it's a fact we can't deny. The moment there is significant there will be personal life problem, there will be, you know, other problems. But at the same time, the quality of output will be higher. So it's a decision one needs to make. At individual level, these are the you know, competing points. But at the institution level, one has to look at if one is a leader, one has to look at not at individual level, but at institutional level, and see what is the need of the hour for the institution, and then make a call.
If you are going for a punishment for Chinese ways of doing things, then of course stress would come. But if it's a reward kind of thing, I don't think.
There will be less stress. I mean, in the US university, there is a strong punishment because you are on a tenure track. So if you don't perform, you're out. That certainly leads to much bigger stress. What is being talked about here is a much lesser stress. But then we must not forget, at least in a institution like IIT Kanpur, and I'm sure this would be true in all your institutions also, the faculty live inside the campus. They live in this big cocoon where whatever they are doing in the day is carried forward in the evening and night. The same set of people discussing the same set of things, and this creates a you don't get a break from
stress.
If there's a problem in the daytime, that problem continues in the evening.
Sir, you can do one thing.
You haven't got promoted, let's say this year, you go back in the evening, you meet the same set of families, you see your friend's kid, he says, uncle is my promoting.
May I submit something, sir? You can do this in a hidden kind of thing, like some component adding to the salary of a person, which is not visible to all.
In a system like yours, nothing is secret. Nothing is secret. There's no way.
Can we do it?
It's possible. It is, as opposed to, if you are not living in the campus, you are living in the city. When you go back home in the evening, then there is so many other people. I like telling you, the neighbors are completely different. Somebody is working at a bank, somebody is doing something. You're talking about conversations are completely different. So that gives a break.
Sir, is there any reward system in place in IIT Kanpur?
We do, yes. There is.
So you can share with us, that would be good.
I will share, but I don't claim that this is the right system. It has caused heartburn, has caused problems. There have been complaints raised against it. But in any way, we have about 40 faculty chairs. We have about 25 young faculty fellowships, which are available to faculty up to 40 years of age. And that's it. We have these two.
But there are external.
There are external ones, and then on top of it, there are the external. Those are more like awards, not rewards.
So is promotion considered to be a reward? If it is, then the parameters which we consider, is it consistent over the years or is it dynamically changing? Does it change our process?
Parameters change dynamically, and they will. Parameters may not be static. What was considered good enough 20 years ago is not good enough. The parameters will definitely change. Promotion is, as you said, promotion is certainly an inherent award system. But it is too sporadic. There is only twice in your lifetime that you face it. Now, right, with HIV promotion. But that's it. In a career spanning 30 years or more, it's I think a little too spaced out.
Sir, is letter of appreciation will work?
You give me an answer. I don't have the answer.
Yes, sir. I think yearly you can give in different parameters. Number of platters will not.
Sir, one point that is coming up is when you say that the depreciation or the promotion or the criteria that we normally fix should be commensurating with the timelines that have passed actually. What happened is a person is as he's moving like ahead in his career, let us say somebody has reached 50. And now if you start implementing the new criteria on the people who have already crossed 50 or 55, at least there is another 5 or 10 years left. So this, there is always a kind of, you know, difficulty to achieve the targets that are, you know, put for an end faculty today for an older faculty.
Yeah, yeah.
So this needs to be addressed suitably. I say that of course there must be some recognition for the high value work or exemplary work that they do. And the parametrics like, you know, the publications or the PhDs, because he has crossed certain, you know, areas. I'm not saying this is true for all branches. There could be difference in science branch, there could be difference in engineering, and engineering also different in different branches. So therefore something has to be done on this. Maybe experts are the best probably to look into this.
That is certainly a valid point, because you know, somebody at 55 years of age who's well used to spending 3 hours in the tea club will find it difficult if suddenly the criteria change.
Will find it difficult to
adopt to the new reality.
So, I'm just extending beyond this the competitive part you said. If you look at the research as an ecosystem, there are other players also there. Now, which we have to compete with them, whether it's a sponsored research from research abroad or any projects which we have to apply or consulting firms which we have to collude, collaborate or collaborate. In either form of all these we have to go for. So how our systems can prepare those for such modalities where we have to work for others, or because those systems or those competitors are more prepared for such situation, for example, going to the state government. Now, they are approaching and they are asking us to be a panelist, a member for them, to bid for the projects. Now, in such situations, internal consistencies are also required to be developed, to go beyond and be part of that system.
Yes.
Yes, sir. I agree with you that we need to be clear in our head completely what we need, what we need, and then do it consistently. We want, if we want that the institute should be known for research technology development, then we need to make sure that the message goes out loud and clear internally. Those who are doing it will be, let's say, more respected than the ones who are not. This message, unless we convey this message, it will be business as usual. We may say whatever we want to say out to the outside world, internally nothing will change. Now, in what way are those who are doing respected is the question. I mean, are they more rewarded? Are they given appreciation letters? Are they, you know, some other way recognized? But recognized they must.
What is the kind of recognition
chair professor here is a 3-year typically. Here is a 3-year tenure which gets an additional salary of 50,000 rupees per month. 25.
So instead of doing that way,
yes,
can it be a softer recognition in the sense that this person is given some extra travel grant, or he is allowed to, or he or she is allowed to invite people for collaborative research or something like that? So that form of the grant doesn't come as a part of salary component,
mm-hmm,
and rather facilitate this person to do more research or better work in his
yes,
domain.
Yes.
Would you think that that is a better idea?
That's one alternate model, yes, that in, you know, this 25,000 into 36 months translates to 9 lakh rupees. So instead of putting 9 lakh rupees in his pocket, give 9 lakh rupees against additional research grant to be spent as one wishes.
No,
travel, do whatever.
Students,
buy.
Students.
We are following this model only, but that is that we have something like early career award and mid career award, where they give the money. Like 30 lakh, they gave me this time, this mid career award. 30 lakh for doing research and one postdoctoral fellow for 2 years, and some money to travel.
But let me, this brings me to the very fundamental point that as seems like as a race, we Indians dislike money, personal money particularly. How can that guy, why is that guy getting more money than me? He should not.
It's like others getting money.
When we, so, I think this, I don't understand this phenomena. Some sociologists may be able to shed more light on it. But it's a fact. This point that, and I've heard it in many places, that why give personal money, why not give research money? It's a fair point. What I don't understand is, why not give personal money? Is there a good reason, except that I feel jealous if somebody gets more money?
The heartburn is very difficult to deal with in the social.
The heartburn, that's the only argument I've heard. Yes, the heartburn is there, it's difficult to deal with.
And probably it is busy from audit point of view also, probably.
Not from audit.
Sir, there are few places where both are there, personal money as well as research grant.
That's it. So I wanted to share. Talking about changing parameters for age 55 or above, it becomes difficult. I recall my first year when I joined here, I was 29. And everything is evaporant, all this happened in the evaporant department. So one of the senior faculty was 60 plus, and he told me, you know, when I saw him on Sundays coming to the lab, he told me, I have to compete with you. And that's why I have to work harder. So I think the other point is that key ingredient is one of the most important thing in my view for really making sure the department performs, because it's a peer pressure. It's not like fighting for jealousy or, you know, for specific reward. It's to make sure that their contribution is equally respected. So I just wanted to share that.
That's a very important point, Mr. Vic, that one component of performance, making people perform is peer pressure. So, but that has requires, so there is, peer pressure can only exist if there are peers. That is, if there are, if all around you, you see outstanding people, then you will be, you know, you'll force yourself, literally, without any external motivation. There are some departments in our institution which are lucky to have such a setup, but generally no.
Sir, cash awards should be always there. Cash awards should be always there. Research funding you can acquire anywhere if you are competent enough. Prioritize good. You can have anywhere you can have funding, but cash award. For example, sir, 25 years before, my one publication, my university gave me 500 rupees cash prize. That has led me to go for 125 publications till today. 500 rupees means something.
So these are very interesting debating points, and I have made my side clear, but I am not claiming to be the right. I don't think there is a right or wrong.
Just one point. You talked about good faculty, students, infrastructure, funding, and then reward amongst the ingredients. Whether reward system is required or not will depend on how strong the other three parameters are in a certain institute. It would vary between, say, an IIT and a state government.
Yes.
So, in a typically like an IIT kind of a setup, what they call as the two-factor theory of motivation. All the ingredients, the first three ingredients are sufficient to have the necessary peer pressure and peer support and all of that. Reward system is not really required. Whereas in in a state university like what Vyasa said, 25 years back, state university, that was a good reward system which has motivated.
No, but I distinctly hear that even in IITs, that there does exist a strong peer group to be motivated. I have seen enough examples where it's a different
No, sir, infrastructure.
Excuse me. Sir, we are grading our students.
Yes.
We are classifying our students. But I don't know why professors are not willing to grade themselves.
Yes, yes,
okay.
Yes.
Number one. In all professions, there is a classification, efficient, very efficient, or less efficient like that. Therefore, it is the order of the day to categorize or to classify ourselves. So we should be subjected to that. When we grade our students, why not we?
Okay. So I think let's move on. I think
actually, what is the harm if performers are given reward? अरे पुराना जमाना में तो राजा लोग देता था सब.
Somebody, my neighbor gets a reward and I don't, I feel upset.
Yeah.
That feeling of upset, being upset, creates negative vibes and I'll find more people who will feel worth feeling upset because they haven't got it. Then we'll create a group and we'll keep reinforcing each other's negative feeling to create a large negative block. That's an upset.
So, with these conflicting thoughts, let's move on.
I talk about ingredients. Ingredients are essential, but not
essential.
You need to mix the ingredients well and cook them properly. So, how do you cook them? That's where institute policies. How the institutions orient and strategize? Teaching versus research. This is a never-ending debate. How much emphasis should we give to teaching? Now that, okay, the presumption here is that we want to our institutions to be known for its leadership in research. The moment you take this view, you would like the faculty to devote more time doing the research. Which means less time for teaching. And that creates a conflict. Because there is a constant lament these days in IIT Kanpur and I'm sure in other institutions also. Because the senior faculty says, oh, the younger lot, they don't care about teaching at all. The only thing they say is, you want to go out of school. And they're not happy. So, what weightage should one give? And research so that teaching is a very important and essential component of being in an institution like ours. It cannot be neglected. Another point is should less load, teaching load be given to good researchers? There's a demand that good researchers make, so we are doing so well. One of the rewards that the good researchers ask for is give us less. Is that good idea? Because it leads to the third point. Does teaching help in research and vice versa? This is often made clear. That if I am doing good research, then I can do, I teach well. If I am teaching well, then I can, that help teaching help with research. If that is the case, there is a contradiction. Because that, if good research researchers are good teachers, why should they be given distinction? That means the poor researchers were poor teachers are being given more teaching. This is unfair to the students.
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, although it's a conventional, but for younger faculty, this should not happen. Teaching should be given equal importance, especially to younger. As far as below 40, somebody is here. So teaching should rather be given more, even if he's a good researcher. He should, equal weight should be given to. But if you go beyond 40, the reason is about students, you need faculty who can mentor the students in future also. All the senior professors will be retiring later on, and you must have some, those who have hands-on experience of teaching. So in future, they would drag or carry forward the institute.
There is an alternate viewpoint, which is completely opposite. It says that the senior faculty should take more teaching. So they are experienced in their research, they have research labs and everything is set up, they have a large body of students to support the research, they have more experience. Be more time teaching, as opposed to a junior person who is struggling to set up the lab, struggling with the student, struggling to define research problem, still has a large career progression to handle, therefore we should give more time.
But sir, teaching comes by experience. All of a sudden you cannot stand to start teaching. Unless you have...
No, the point is not that you don't teach. The point is that it should be allowed more leeway. So if 3 courses are to be taught by 2 persons, the senior professor should get 2 courses and the junior one should get 1.
Sir, good researchers are always well updated with the knowledge. So they should be given equal teaching work.
Yeah.
From my experience, what I have seen, a strategy which seems to be working is to ease the faculty who just joins by giving that person 1 semester off and then gradually easing him in, first by having him as a tutor, and then he just works up the chain from, because the natural tendency would be for a faculty to have to float a elective in his subject of expertise, let it be, but eventually move on to teaching a department compulsory course and then eventually the core course. So that way you kind of build up the momentum, and this all should happen within 4 semester or 2 year, 2.5 years time frame.
Actually, in earlier days, the young teachers were given the designation as lecturer. Then, after promotion, they turned to be reader, then professor. The duty of the professor is to profess. Reader. Reader's duty is to read. Lecturer is to teach.
Nice.
That was very important. Because by teaching, they will clear their idea and they will be reader.
But I would say that was the model when teaching was the sole purpose of.
Yes. The model that we were talking about, where, you know, because of which we are here, actually, you see, when you start with 1926, you know, ISM was established or DHO established in 2011 and IITs. You can see the model was teaching as a primary job,
right,
to create, you know, talent pool. And that has resulted, you know, marvels actually, that it created a number of, you know, talent pool and all that. That's how the ranking has gone up. And then now, by just, you know, the research has to, you know, invade into the, get into the portals actually. We are not stopping it, but then teaching should not lose its priority. I think.
But it will have to, you know, there is, you know, a person works, let's say, 10 hours a day. If you say that earlier, when a faculty member was spending 8 hours on the teaching in a day and 2 hours for doing other things. Today, the demand of research is that the person has to work 6-7 hours a day in research. The teaching time left is much less. This will impact teaching. We have to be completely aware of this fact. Now, Only thing is, what extent should we allow this impact, teaching to be impact? Where should one draw the line?
Sir, a teacher may not be a good researcher and vice versa.
That's also possible.
So in that case, why can't we earmark a certain percentage of the post in the department as teaching professors and research professors? Or like that?
That's a model. Yes, that is possible. Potential solution that you create two cadres within the faculty. One who are not expected to do research, like the old ones. They are just, the old part, they are just there for doing teaching. And there is another cadre which is doing both teaching and but who is more focused on this.
So even within, I'm just trying to tell the model which we are trying to evolve.
Mm.
So even within people, there are people who are really passionate about teaching and people who are
yep.
just teaching for the so what we can do is, we are trying to do is, at a 3-year period or a 5-year period. And we also believe that we should, everybody should share the teaching load equally. So we are giving opportunities that if a person wants to focus on research, for instance, so there are these half courses, or, so you double up your load in one semester and take a free for the other.
Take off the next semester.
So this is something which we have been doing very regularly so that people who want to take an advantage, everybody is given an equal opportunity for the other thing is, you know, as Anish mentioned, a person who is coming to the department for settling down, you try to give the first semester off. So, and if you look at it, at the end of 3 years, we just tabulate everything. So there is a data which is available. You make sure that more or less everybody is teaching all kind of courses.
But that's a democratic way of spreading the teaching. That's one model. There are other models which say that no, they need not be fully democratic or fully equal load to on everyone.
So right now, the ideal weightage is 70% teaching, 30% research. Once you become little senior teacher, automatically you are getting students, postgraduate students, and you start guiding. So automatically, research problem has been addressed in that.
I'm not sure if that would happen. Because it hasn't happened historically. I mean, IITs and IITs have been very good institutions for teaching for a very, very long time. But that hasn't really increased the research. It's only when the society started demanding that we are looking for more research output that we have started changing.
Sir, in my opinion,
30-70
would be good. 30 for teaching, 70 for research, and number of faculty members, that is the teacher-student ratio should be increased so that the classroom teaching and teaching available to the student is available as per the need of the BTEC student. Particularly the major stakeholder which needs to be addressed quite effectively is the undergraduate group. Under no condition should an institution let that undergraduate lot suffer for whatsoever reason. For an individual faculty, it should be 30-70.
Mm-hmm.
30 to teaching, 70 to research. And yesterday, Pramath told us that statutorily, if possible, the academicians must be brought out of the routine administrative setups. And we can get a lot of time through that. Whatever is not academic administration, we should not push academicians to it. Because faculty is a scarce resource. Most of the institutions are not having enough. And therefore, 30-70 would work because of the population, research needs have increased suddenly. We really need research to solve the societal problem. Therefore, 70% is probably
okay.
will be able to meet.
So,
another important aspect I want to say regarding this curriculum, that is undergraduate courses and master courses, there is also difference.
That's
so,
fine, but that's not important for this.
Because teaching is related to undergraduate courses, because we have to give the instruction.
So you want to
they will
more
learn
more.
That period. So research will come after undergraduate. In postgraduate.
Okay.
Sir, I think being a teaching institute, we should have maximum concentration on teaching only because we have an exclusively research institution also in the country. who are addressing all 100% research. Second thing, sir, in university system, we are a little different than IITs. The thing is, after 2 years probation, a teacher is getting a postgraduate student. And we have master's level must by thesis. So at that time, our all the research ideas got nurtured properly.
Fair enough, I would say that's the case model which one needs to consider, and there are a bunch of models, and like I said, I don't have the answer which is the right one. I don't think there is the right answer. So everybody has to exercise some judgment. All I would say is whatever model overall that is decided has to be consistent and articulated very clearly. This is the model. Faculty evaluation, we have already talked about, should it be done yearly or only at the time of promotion?
Yeah.
I think it's a thing to do that every year, in the form of a feedback, the faculty is informed. This is your performance, and maybe these are the places where.
Yearly assessment and say IIT Ratna, IIT Suraj.
Well, that's the reward system you're talking about. We already discussed that, yeah. And every institute must get evaluated once in 5 years by an external set of experts. That is very important. We tend to look at ourselves and conclude that we are doing very well, but it's good to have an external set of experts also look at it. They can look at it from outside and suggest some problems which we would otherwise not recognize.
So is there any, you know, conscious effort from IIT Kanpur to improve its ranking? Conscious effort?
Conscious effort to no. No step has, okay, there is only step that has been taken, which is exclusively for improving ranking, is to collect better data, to be fed to the ranking. Better data, right? So when we started, the data that was being given to ranking agencies was itself very much more.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
We are trying to become more international.
That is so.
Rankings.
That was the collection of data is the only purely ranking specific activity. Becoming international, you know, doing more technology development or publishing more papers has an aspect which is for improving ranking, but it has other aspects also. Need a more ranking.
My point is that you deliberated this issue within IIT.
That improving the international angle is explicit strategy that we have adopted only in last few years, and the push is certainly strongly motivated by that. Okay. Promotion. That's a very touchy subject. Faculty. Associate professor requires 6 years as assistant professor. No, 6 years post PhD experience with 3 years as assistant professor. What I have observed in a large number of faculty, that the moment they complete the 6 years, they expect to be promoted. Is that the right approach towards promotion? That is the minimum eligibility criteria sufficient to get promoted? Or should there be more gradation? That is, in the minimum time, 6 years, if you are doing really well, then you get promoted. Otherwise, you wait. Maybe those who are doing reasonably well get promoted in 8 years. Those who are doing just so-so get promoted in 10 years. Should there be such gradation in the promotion duration depending on the performance?
Should be, sir. It is a minimum eligibility.
minimum. So this is a minimum. So it only allow you to apply for it.
Right.
It does not, you know, ensure you.
True. That is, that's the literal meaning of it, but it often gets confused or conflated with this being sufficient to get promoted.
Minimum is the person who is a very good performer. For him, it is, let us say, 4 years minimum condition. So minimum, the moment you put minimum, that means all parameters are 100% high. And that is why you are giving him this, we call it is accelerated promotion. If you are giving promotions in minimum time, so it is a kind of accelerated promotion. And accelerated promotion are to be given to only those faculty who are very good performers.
Okay.
Sir, in universities we have two-way system.
Okay.
Accelerated promotion means selection. We are advertising.
And then
people are competing and getting.
Yes.
At 3 years also they get. Otherwise they have to wait up for 10 years also.
So is there a consensus here that the promotion duration should be variable depending on the performance?
Yeah.
So
yes.
Fantastic. So. The hard part is actually implemented. And that's where again the leadership comes. This point needs to be articulated very clearly and right up front.
Yes.
This is what the institute policy is. Please do not expect anything else. Otherwise there will be confusion. Even more controversial. Tenure track. So this is very prevalent in US and other countries that when a new assistant professor joins the institute, he or she is on a tenure track position. After 5, 6 or whatever number of years, there is an evaluation back. If the evaluation is good, the person is promoted and made tenure, that is permanent. Otherwise, he or she may be asked to wait, maybe apply again after a couple of years. The third possibility is that he or she is asked to wait. The advantages are that it forces, literally forces the young faculty to work very hard. That's the, at that age, has the capacity to work in the country, has a lot of new factors. So this setup really makes use of those abilities that a young person has to extract excellent work. The downside is high divorce rates. The high divorce rates. It's also true. Because you are divorced. If a person is sitting in the lab or in the office for like 16 hours a day, there is bound to be repercussions. There is certainly more stress. There is a very strong streak of competitiveness. Actually, much more in the US. For example, if there are tenure track professors in, say, MIT, they know that there is only one position for which 5 of them are competing. You know, so 4 will have to go. And that kind of stress that creates is phenomenally high. Fortunately, that's not the case here. In our system, if there are 5 people, they all 5 can get it. Don't have any shortage of number of positions. The only thing is that we should cross a certain threshold in terms of performance indicators. So a tenure track position in our system would be certainly less stressful, much less stressful than in the US system. At the same time, it will be more stressful than what it is. Is that a good idea?
Yes, sir.
IISc Bangalore, just a data point, IISc Bangalore has now implemented a tenure track position. Last few years, they have evaluated and actually asked some faculty members to that's,
you
know, that's a very
good track,
yeah,
and so on.
Correct.
I know people who have sacrificed their entire family life for focusing on career,
yes,
or the other way around.
Right.
Okay, and by the time, if you are taking care of a family and you reach the situation of you know, building back the career, etc., most of the people give it up.
Correct.
And who survive, and you know, they are not eligible for most of what so-called awards.
Right. That's
so
true.
I think there is a fundamental change which is necessary, whether it is tenure track, whether it is promotion, because you know you are neglecting more than 50% of the population.
Correct. That's a very important point. That has to be factored into any such system. That for women, how do you adopt? If you, there is to be a tenure track system, how do you adopt?
I have a request for a small correction.
Yes.
What madam said, it should not be women friendly, it should be spouse friendly.
No, there is a difference there.
Finally, the reproduction part is to be.
No, women there is definitely there is a difference here. Women,
in for the rearing of the young child, women bear the disproportionate amount of responsibility, and therefore they need time off, and that time off has to be factored in.
Sir, things are changing very fast.
That's a crucial period of
career. Sir, things are changing very fast. After 15-20 years, you are going to have house husbands instead of
Because in India, it will not happen. Let's not get into that. All I'm saying is, these policies, I already said, are dynamic. They cannot be static. We have to look at the policy as it exists today. What happens in the future?
This tenure track position may not work in the university system. Because what happened is that when you say 3 years or 4 years,
can you,
yeah, 3 or 4 years, when he or she joins, he or she will be looking at a permanent position somewhere else. Moreover, they won't be able to, you know, put their 100% in teaching, because they are always looking in terms of a permanent position where they can have a, you know, future. Like, therefore, this may not work in university system.
You are looking at permanent position somewhere else.
Yeah, somewhere else means now they have got, let's say, 3 years contract in a university.
Oh, yes, because it's a contract, they want.
They want to look and look for a permanent position. They will apply somewhere else.
No, but
and the kind of.
So that's the point, that tenure track system is not going to work in one institution. But if all the institutions adopt it, then that problem will go away.
Yeah.
But if you are on a contract there, you think you won't get it. You will fill your contract.
NITs are there, universities are there.
So one type of institution. So like IIT Bangalore,
it
being a unique institution, can adopt it and still
can work. IIT can
all IITs together, if you adopt it, then it can be.
Yes.
All NITs together, if they adopt it, then it can be.
Yeah.
So one of the major problems, in my opinion, is that there is no mechanism. If somebody is not performing after being getting permanent position after 1 year, and the rest of the 30 years, the person, it remains non-performer, is not contributing to the system at all. There is no other way. There is no mechanism to fix it. And it's basically, it's like a pulling force. So how do we take care of that? Either through the tenure track or in general, some other mechanism.
In selection, we have a reservation for females. Same in promotion also, we can introduce such reservation. No, no, see, madam, it is there. It is government rule. It is not your opinion. It is government rule. UGC rule. That 30%, okay, woman can get. Correct? It is open rule.
No.
In selection, we are following.
State government.
And second thing, sir. Second thing. As madam told that, woman candidate has so many other problems also. But in such cases, when candidate appears for the eligibility, everything is to be considered by the authority. It we have generally seen. We have generally seen.
A special provision or a special model has to be evolved, appropriate model, for
to catering which fits a women's career and the way it evolves. Because the way men's career evolves is quite different from the way women's career evolves.
So this doesn't mean any way compromise on quality.
Correct. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that the guidelines will have to be appropriately changed.
So
okay. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So may I request you to hold your questions and let me.
Okay. Let's wind up. This is my last slide.
Okay. That's a good
thing. I just made 9 slides. Actually, 8 slides. We've all the time.
Sir, I have a query. So I like this. I mean, the suggestion, of course, is very logical that one has to be, once you decide a course that best is optimally suited for your institute, then stick to it, be consistent, and of course, articulate it so that all the stakeholders are aware of it. Now, issue is that selection committee, final call for the someone getting in the recruitment is of the selection committee. Now, if someone gets selected, I mean, the selection committee makes its call and says that, okay, well, you know, I feel that the person has done this and this, she deserves to be promoted. At that point of time, that whole Chinese whisper campaign and innuendo start, what, in your opinion, an administrator should be really doing?
Yes.
Reaching out and telling the people that, you know, this is what we found good in that particular person. How do you overcome that?
Very important point. First, as the director is the chairman of the selection, the director, first of all, needs to articulate all the external experts, the institute's practice. This is what institute is looking for in its faculty to be promoted or hired. After this articulation, the experts will more or less evaluate perfect individuals based on that articulation and then make a recommendation. That recommendation in some form, because there are always some candidates, and there are some candidates about which there is no question. Everybody knows that they are very good. So they get promoted, there is no question. But then there are a bunch of candidates who are, so to say, on the border. Some of them may get promoted, some of them may not, depending on so many other factors. That is where a leader has to come out with a clear articulation of, without giving too many details of what happened in the selection committee, that here are the reasons, here are the strengths that the selection committee formed in the candidates, and therefore. And the ones who were not promoted, here are the weaknesses that were there in the view of the experts, and that point is very important. Otherwise, as Anish said, it would lead to this whispers in the corridor and something, this happened, that happened. This guy went to meet with the expert in the night and before the and all things.
Is there need for a director to share this thing with the secretary?
It is not that call an open house and share, no, but to the relevant faculty, certainly.
Because sometimes it could be really disastrous sharing such things or deliberations of the interview board.
Not deliberations. I'm saying the strengths and weaknesses of the
candidates. Sir, I have got some specific points. Like IIT Kanpur, definitely I consider to be a leader in the research. And I would like just to know how many technology transfer has been done from IIT Kanpur, and what is the annual income through IPR, if any statistics you can provide.
All I don't know the exact number, but what I can say is that it's an embarrassingly low number. Very few technology transfers have taken place, and very little money is earned through IP.
Actually, sir, this is where we are also realizing that seriously we are lacking too much on the research front, doing some research, publishing in a good journal, or at the most filing patent, and forget about that afterwards. So something I feel that we need to strengthen this link, from our research finding till commercialization.
I think institute policies will play a very important role. Often we pay only a lip service to that, we want technology development, we want this to see the light of the day, whatever is developed. There is a significant amount of effort that is required in taking the technology from the lab to the market. Of course, if academia world cannot do that, there needs some help, but still, from lab to the next stage of development, which is actually usable prototype, it still requires some amount of effort. That effort needs to be supported and acknowledged.
Actually, sir, this we have organized now only for the last 2 years. So we are preparing this pipeline, probably this will happen in the future. So, as you said, there is a need to, someone who can take my research from lab to the market.
Yeah.
Sir, for that it is required that we know the societal need and a connect is required. Unfortunately, we elevate ourselves or isolate both to such an extent that what society needs, we do not really know. I was once interacting with a mithai wala, sir, jisse dahi aur paneer leta tha. Maine kaha, suppose hum IIT hain, hum tumhare liye kuch karna chahte hain, tumhari kya zarurat hai? Technics hone wala tha sir, model wala competition. Maine kaha, main students ko de dunga, problem kuch karke laayenge. तो बोला सर, हमारी प्रॉब्लम है कि पनीर को हम कंप्रेस करते हैं, उसमें काफ़ी टाइम लगता है. सो इफ यू कैन एक्सपेडाइट द कंप्रेशन ऑफ पनीर फ्रॉम फटे दूध, सो आई कैन मेक मोर पनीर पर डे. सो इज बेसिक प्रॉब्लम इज दैट स्मॉल थिंग. सो इफ यू नो दैट्स नॉट अ बिग थिंग फॉर एन IIT टू डू. सिमिलरली एज अ माइन इंजीनियर सर, वी यूज हेलमेट्स. सो आई टोल्ड माई क्लास दैट we carry a lot of gas indicators and sensors and all that. Can you integrate the two, that when he is wearing a helmet, it should have a sensor, and the moment quantity of gas is rising above TLV, it should put an alarm. The fellow was able to do under DIN. We have a design and innovation hub. So 35,000 was given to him from institute, and he came out with a product. So if the need is defined, if we get connected to societal need, probably lot of products could come.
Correct. That's it. Just a matter of connecting with the society, extracting and asking our students are uniformly bright, giving them this problem.
Yes, sir.
They can solve this.
It may not be a trivial.
It requires an institutional setup.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
It won't happen in isolation. It will happen in isolation, but it won't.
Sir, what I'm saying is, if institution takes this, probably we would be much more functional and a lot of things can come within shorter period of time.
Okay, so finally, we have already discussed research focus, we have been discussing throughout, towards technology development, solving societal problems, conductual research. I think we all are agreeing that the time has come for our institution more on technology development, solving societal problems. Fundamental research, of course, will keep going. So, I think these are, I'm sorry, I have left you with a lot of questions, not too many answers, but that's what
that,
I have.
That will lead to part two of LEAP.
And since I am supposed to give something to work on, so I have a very simple question to you. Suppose you get a greenfield university, that is, you can create a university from ground up. Decide the policy. How would you want that university in terms of all of this?
With assured funding.
Funding also. You assume that there will be some funding, yes, but it will be constrained from the ministry and
all. We have to contact
how would you structure your It's too broad a question?
Yes, sir. It's my page limit here. Yeah. A DPR for a university.
Not a DPR. No, I think limit to the question that I have raised and some of the decision points. You want reward system, do you not want reward system? What kind of reward system do you want? Do you want to be more focused on society development, technology development? What structures, some of the structures you would like to put in order to achieve that? If it not to elaborate, and I will certainly not be at the DPR level of details that this is as we have. A couple of pages.
Any more questions? Discuss thing? Let us